Okay, good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. Our first agenda item today is to hear from the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and I refer members to Papers 1 and 2. I'd like to welcome to our meeting Ian Duddy, Chair, Ailey Dixon, Policy and International Officer, and Commissioner Jim Farish. You're all very welcome. If we could start by inviting Ian Duddy to make a short opening statement, please.
Well, thank you very much for inviting us to come along today. We recently published our annual report for 2020-2021. I should just stress that none of us actually were in position during that period in 2020-2021, but happy to take questions on the report and also set out our vision for the years ahead. I also want to take this opportunity to thank my predecessor, Judith Robertson, who led the organisation for 6 years. She left office in March 2021. I thought it might be helpful just to explain our mandate and some sort of headline issues briefly. So just to explain, we are a public body, independent of Scottish Government, but funded by the taxpayer via Parliament. My position is appointed by Parliament, and we have, under our mandate, up to 4 commissioners who work part-time. So Jim is one of those new commissioners. We currently have 3 commissioners in position. Our powers are to conduct inquiries, intervene in relevant civil court cases, publish research, give training, make recommendations to law, but we don't have powers to litigate, and nor are we able to take on legal complaints. The UK has 3 national human rights institutions, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission, the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission, and the Scottish Human Rights Commission. So we're a little bit unique in having 3 UN-recognised institutions. In 2020-21, we had a budget of £1.2 million, and most of that is spent on our staff. Around 85% of our total budget is staff costs. Our total staff headcount is 12.5. We're hoping to increase that to 14.5 next financial year. We've submitted a budget bid for next financial year of £1.37 million. Compared to the other 2 UK NHRIs, the Equalities and Human Rights Commission and the Northern Ireland Commission, we are quite lean. So in comparison, the Northern Ireland Commission had a budget of 2.3 million in 2020-21 and 22 staff, and the Equalities and Human Rights Commission had a budget of 17.1 million and 183 staff. Obviously our mandates are a bit different, but we are a small NHRI in comparison. We're halfway through our 4-year strategic plan, which runs from 2020 to 2024. We have 4 key strategic priorities that we're aiming to deliver. Number 1, progressing the understanding and strengthening legal protection of economic, social and cultural rights. Number 2, strengthening accountability for human rights. Number 3, building wider ownership of human rights. And number 4, advancing best practice locally and sharing our knowledge globally. In the other thing I'd like to mention in 2020-2021, covered by this report, is that our A status as a national human rights institution was reviewed by the UN, and I'm pleased to say that our A status was renewed. Looking forward in terms of the next year ahead, some of the issues that we're planning to be working on include the plans by the Scottish Government for a new human rights bill and incorporating several treaties into Scots law. That will be a big piece of work, and that may result in the Commission having additional powers. So we need to think through what that means in terms of our own work and resourcing. The UK was recently reviewed on its human rights record at the UN under the Universal Periodic Review just last month, and commitments were made by the UK and Scottish Government, so we'll be looking to follow those up over the next year or two. We also work quite heavily in the justice sector, so prison inspections and prison monitoring. That was suspended during COVID, but we'd like to renew our work on that, obviously working hand in hand with the prisons inspectorate. And also the cost of living crisis, addressing that in the year ahead, particularly around housing, health, access also to mental health and minimum core obligations. So I just wanted to give the committee convener a flavour of some of the things that are coming up in the year ahead, and perhaps some of the things that the committee may want to look at as well.
That's really, really helpful. Thanks for that. You mentioned COVID there, so probably just skip straight to that, I think, actually, and just, there's obviously a degree of work has been paused because of COVID, development of the strategic litigation being one of the areas. It'd be good just to get an idea of what else has been paused and, you know, what plans there are to pick up anything that was paused because of COVID.
Yeah, so in 2020-2021, we had to divert some of our work onto COVID. The Commission in that period issued quite a lot of guidance to the government, to Chief Medical Officer, around recommendations on vaccines, certifications. We made a statement about human rights in care homes. Also feeding into the Scottish Government's COVID inquiry and the terms of reference for that inquiry. So we had to divert a fair bit of work to respond to COVID. And at the same time, some other work was paused. So I mentioned prison inspections. We're hoping to work with partners to pick that up in 2023. Also some of our work on participation, lived experience, some of that had to be paused or done in a different way. There's a bit of a challenge, I think, in COVID with a digital divide as well. Not everyone is able to dial in via Zoom, and so that means actually reaching some more marginalised or vulnerable communities can be a challenge. And also the pandemic highlighted new areas, some of the things that we mentioned in our report to the Universal Periodic Review around mental health, social care, disabilities, and the struggle in for some communities in accessing services locally.
Okay, thank you. One of the areas you mentioned, I know one of my colleagues is keen to press further on. So, Rachel, this might, we're talking about prisons, so it probably is as good a place as any for you to cover the area.
It was just really to ask you, in terms of what you expect of the Prisons Inspectorate and the report that you had published, with regards, could you talk us through the recommendations that you have made and you know, what you expect of ensuring that deaths in custody review is acknowledged by the Parliament?
Yes, so... So my predecessor, Judith Robertson, worked closely with the Prison Inspectorate and also a civil society group called Families Outside around the Death in Custody Review, which was published this time last year. So a year since that review was published, and we understand the Scottish Government accepted most of the recommendations, in fact, all of the recommendations. I think we have some questions about whether those recommendations are being followed up and implemented. We're now a year into that review. Jill Immery, who is currently reviewing that work, is expected to publish a report very soon. We will want to ensure that those recommendations that the Scottish Government agreed to are implemented. One of the key ones was whenever there is a death in custody, that there should be an independent investigation. And so we'd like to see that in practice. I don't know whether I'll ask my colleague Jim whether he wants to add anything on that, given his background.
Only to say we've met with Gillian, and we know that there's work ongoing to challenge the uptake on the recommendations, and that there are some actions have already been taken regarding contacting how to contact next of kin from and who should make that contact from the establishment. So there is some work being done, but I think the report's not due out until the middle of the month.
But another question on this. Obviously, it's a really important report. What powers does the SHRC have over the Parliament in terms of ensuring that, you know, we do carry out the recommendations that you have set in place? Do we have, you know, what is the process of this? Does it, in the past, have these reports just gone to one side if the Parliament decides not to take it up? Is it just in our gift to be able to take this forward, or can you put pressure on us as the parliamentarians?
I think that's a really interesting question. I think some of the responsibility does lie within this committee to do some of that follow-up. We do not have powers in terms of, you know, there's a separation between ourselves and the prisons inspectorate. So we do not have powers to litigate against the Scottish Government if we found them to be failing. But I do think there's a role for us as the NHRI to explain and question when public commitments are not being followed up. We've also done some work on a related matter around remand in Scotland as well. Again, figures are quite high compared to the rest of the UK. So I think the justice sector is one of the areas that we will be wanting to follow up next year.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for the information that you've provided so far. During the pandemic, obviously, a number of things had to pause, and you were doing some work, as I understand, on the COVID inquiry. In your view, does the terms of reference that have been updated as a result of Lady Poole's resignation, do they take account of human rights? Do you expect that the inquiry will be taking that frame, or is there anything further that we as a committee can do or parliamentarians can do to make sure that that's the case?
Yes, so in terms of the terms of reference, we lobbied openly and publicly for the inquiry to take a human rights-based approach. I'm really pleased by the recent commitments by the Deputy First Minister to say that that approach has been included in the terms of reference, so we're pleased that that's been made explicit. I think one of the roles that we have is to ensure that that is implemented throughout the inquiry. And so we will be following up with Lord Brailsford and the COVID-19 inquiry team about next steps on that.
Thank you. Do you have a view about what that would look like in terms of the inquiry?
I think it's too early to say, but I think the inquiry team will need to strike a balance between making sure that those most affected by the pandemic and the most marginalised groups and individuals have a chance to give evidence, and that there should be a proper participatory process by those most affected by the pandemic. Obviously, that there's a balance being struck between sort of 15,000 families perhaps wanting to give evidence, but trying to do it in a way where that's inclusive as possible, so that everyone gets a chance to contribute.
Do you think that is the inquiry going to take your advice on that? Are you intending giving them advice on how to do that, or do you know how they're going to approach it?
So we haven't met yet the new chair of the inquiry team, but we're planning to do that before Christmas and to follow up on that conversation.
Thank you. I just have one further question about the staffing and resources. In your opening statement, you mentioned that you were a lean organisation and that you're hoping to build up to 14.5 members of staff in the coming year. We'll come on, I think, to talk a little bit more about some of the incorporation and other aspects of that. But if that were the case, do you expect that you would have to exceed the 14.5 members of staff on the basis of further incorporation? And do you have a sense as to why? I mean, are you proportionately leaner than the other organisations that you mentioned, or do you have specifically less resource and staff?
Yeah, so our mandates are a bit different. So in Northern Ireland, they do have powers for strategic litigation. We don't. I think if the new bill meant that there were new obligations placed on us as a commission, particularly around legal powers, we're not staffed to do that at the moment. So we would need to increase resources. The bid we put in for next financial year is basically steady state, just to keep the ship still sailing. If we have additional powers, I think we will be needing additional legal resource. At the moment, we have two full-time legal officers. You know, we're quite lean.
Thank you. That's all the questions in that area. Convener, thanks.
Thanks. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. Ian, if I can follow on from Pam Duncan-Glancy's line of questioning around staffing and really just how the Commission is at the moment, because, yes, we've been through some of the impacts of COVID and we've talked about some of that, but there's also, as you outlined in your opening remarks, been a significant amount of organisational change. And I suppose I've got a few questions in the space, and I'm interested how are your staff, how's the team feeling? And I suppose I should also declare that as a member of the corporate body, I will be scrutinising the budget that you've put in for next year. But just interested to know how the team is doing.
Yeah, so it's been a challenging year, not just for COVID, but also quite a big change in staff, also having a new set of commissioners. There was a gap between my predecessor leaving and me starting of 3 to 4 months. Perhaps that's something that could be looked at in the future in terms of succession planning. I mean, mm-hmm. that's within this committee's gift, yeah. In terms of recruitment to avoid that gap. We've had quite a bit of staff turnover as well. So we've had to ruthlessly prioritise what we've been working on. I'm grateful to the Parliament's corporate board for providing us with a finance director to make sure that we were able to complete our report and make sure that all our invoices and staff were continued to be paid. We've got two new senior staff joining us in January, so a new executive director and a new finance director. So I think that will help rebalance. I guess it's worth clarifying as well, there's a difference between the chair's role, which is a full-time role, and the commissioners mm-hmm. who are part-time. As a commission, the part-time commissioners, including Jim, is responsible for strategic oversight, but the operational executive decision-making rests with the chair. We're also looking to outsource some functions, so things like payroll. We're quite a small organisation, less than 20 people. So there are other... we're being encouraged by Parliament to look at shared services. Yeah. We already share our building with a number of other public bodies, share reception facilities, and now sharing things like payroll.
Okay. Thanks, Ian. I think... The Human Rights Commission isn't the only commission that's talking about sharing services like payroll and those kind of back office functions. Jim, can I ask you in your newish role now, how do you find the balance between the strategic work that you and your fellow commissioners are asked to do and the sort of operational side that Ian heads up? Do you think we've got the balance right in that? Do you think we're actually allowing... Notwithstanding the requests for additional staff that Ian has already outlined, but do you think we've got that kind of balance between strategy and operations right?
I think it's a ongoing sort of analysis that needs to be undertaken as mm-hmm. what the balance is. What I would say about the staffing is, coming from a big organisation as I did to such a small organisation, it's impressive the volume of work that's produced by such a small core group of staff. So, you know, credit to the staff for doing that. But no, I do think there is some work needs to be done around about that balance between the strategy and the operational side of things, and making sure that the commissioners are there to support and help develop as opposed to developing sort of noses in finger, if noses in, fingers out sort of approach.
Yeah.
Whereas I think possibly that maybe that balance wasn't quite right in the past, but that's something I think we've already discussed and we'll look to develop over the coming months, especially when the two new senior staff members come in. Yeah. You'll then have a sort of operational function within the commission staffing group that will allow a lot of maybe the work that's slipped to the commissioners to be rebalanced.
Thanks. That's really helpful. My final question, Ian, you talked about the shift from 12.5 to 14.5 members of staff, and that would be steady state. I suppose given what's coming at you or coming at all of us with the Human Rights Bill and incorporation and some of the distinct legal and constitutional challenges around that, never mind just the human rights bit, when you say steady state, how much additional resource would you anticipate needing? Or I suppose I know that some of those conversations will have started with the staff in the Parliament that support you, but where are conversations with that going?
Yes, it's a good question, and a key, I think, challenge for us in 2023 is to map that out. Okay. To be clear, having two additional staff is really just regularising two fixed-term contracts that we have.
Right.
So it's not an overall addition to our capacity, it's an overall addition to our permanent headcount.
Mm-hmm.
We need to see the shape of the bill when it comes through. We were expecting a consultation before Christmas, but I understand that's been pushed into 2023. So we'd need to see the detail to work out exactly what is being proposed. But from initial conversations, we understand that there could be a move for, and again, you know, this is in the hands of Parliament in terms of the role of the Commission with these new treaties being enshrined in Scots law, the Commission having that sort of regulatory type of function, mm-hmm. which would be different to the mandate that we have at the moment. And if that means things like strategic litigation, I would envisage us needing a new set of lawyers to be able to take cases to court and to follow them all the way through.
Okay, no, that's helpful. I suppose one more, if I can. There's also been discussions around commissioners for other bits of rights, and I just wondered how you view the SHRC's role in as kind of an overarching body, or how you see that developing or potentially developing.
Yeah, so again, really interesting question. So there's been several proposals for additional public bodies covering women's rights, an older persons commission, a victims commission. I think I'm aware of perhaps a proposal around autism and neurodiversity. So we're open-minded. I think in our mandate, it's quite clear that we shouldn't duplicate functions, and I think that should work both ways, particularly given the challenge that we are all facing around public finances. So making sure that if new commissions are created, there's a sort of clarity of purpose and that they're not duplicating functions that we carry out. We are the NHRI for Scotland. Yeah. Our mandate is meant to be wide and broad and cover all human rights issues. I think the devil is in the detail on that.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there.
Thanks. Pam, did you want to come in this area? Yep.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, and thank you for providing the information. You mentioned in your opening statement that you're setting out the plan, the vision ahead. With that in mind, we all know that the UNCRC bill would have a significant impact on the work of the Scottish Human Rights Commission, such as through the powers introduced by Section 10A. Given there is continuing uncertainty around when the amended bill will be reintroduced to Parliament, is this uncertainty causing any issues for the Commission in their long-term planning? And would the Commission like to see more clarity from the Scottish Government around the timescales for the bill's reintroduction?
Yeah, thank you. I think that in some ways relates to the previous question as well. So there is in Scotland a separate Child Rights and Young Persons Commission. So again, we try not to duplicate their work. So they have led on most of the sort of policy and legal analysis of the CRC bill, given that it's within their mandate. But as the NHRI, we support the work of Bruce Adamson and the rest of his commission. And we do want to see clarity from the Scottish Government about the bill and its introduction. And we hope that the Scottish Government introduces the announced amendments as soon as possible.
Can I just go back? Thank you for that information. In relation to clarity, just asking, obviously you've talked about your budget and what you're hoping to, your ask is for the year ahead. Is this included in that, or is there uncertainty that the fact that you're looking for more staff and you're looking for more money, but you're not certain about when this work is going to come through? So I know it could affect your long-term planning, but also in relation to the budget side as well.
Yes, so in terms of our sort of medium-term planning, we are awaiting the detail on not just on UNCRC, but also on the new Human Rights Bill. We want to make sure that we're properly staffed and budgeted for that. It's a bit difficult at this moment to totally predict what we will need in future years, but I think we will be coming back to this committee in 2023. To come back to you with a more firmer proposal about what our needs are.
Thank you. And Fulton MacGregor.
To the panel. It's actually following on from Maggie Chapman's line of questioning. And I was wanting to ask about, you'll be aware that the UK government are proposing a British Bill of Rights, and the Scottish government has plans to introduce a Scottish Human Rights Bill. Have you had any thought how that's going to change the human rights landscape across the UK, particularly focusing on Scotland, but across the whole UK, and how that might interact? Has there been any thoughts amongst your team on that?
Sure, and I'll ask Ailey, one of my colleagues, to also respond on this. But for the record, we have been, as a commission, quite open and public about our concerns with the proposed Bill of Rights and the implications for Scotland, given that the Human Rights Act is enshrined in Scots law. We think that the Human Rights Act is working well for Scotland. We are not clear about some of the intent behind the Bill of Rights and concerned about its regressive effects. We have published a briefing in the summer. We gave evidence to the Joint Committee on Human Rights in Westminster about the Bill of Rights. We understand there may be a second reading before Christmas, and we intend to continue with our advocacy and questioning about the bill.
Thanks very much for that. And I think that many members would share those concerns, but as that bill progresses, will you commit to keeping the committee up to date with your own thoughts and analysis of that?
Sure. So the evidence that we gave in the summer to the Westminster Committee and all our evidence, whether it's to Westminster or to this Parliament, is public and published on our website. And yes, it's something that we will be working on in the year ahead, and we'll keep the committee informed. I'll just check with my colleague Ailey to see whether I've missed anything there.
No, thanks. Thanks, Ian. Just to say, as we've outlined in previous submissions to both Westminster and to the Scottish Parliament, we are quite concerned about some of the technical impacts of the Bill of Rights. It was noticeable in the Universal Periodic Review that a significant number of recommendations in that from other states referred to the proposals, some of them at a sort of structural level, some of them at a more technical level. One of the concerns I think that we have around the general landscape that you noted in your question is the Scotland Act and the restriction on the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament in relation to convention rights, and how that might lead to uncertainty around the legal landscape about the level of protection or the interpretation of some of the convention rights under the Human Rights Act and the Scotland Act. I think we're concerned that not enough scrutiny has been given to that particular point in the conversation so far. We are aware that the UK government is engaging with the Scottish government around some of the more technical matters of the bill, but we're not yet seeing any evidence that the UK government really understands the constitutional impacts of some of the recommendations and how those might lead to uncertainty in the process. In terms of updating the committee, I think we can definitely commit to sending you things that we're publishing, and we are intending to put out a briefing and a sort of summary of our concerns around the Stage 2 debate for the Bill of Rights, which, as far as I'm aware, had not been scheduled yesterday when I caught up with my colleague leading on this, but we expect that to be forthcoming in the next few weeks.
I mean that, thanks very much for that response. That's quite a big statement in there, I feel, around about perhaps the UK government. You're feeling that the UK government are not quite getting the complexities of how it could impact in Scottish law and human rights. I know you both have already touched on it, but can I ask what work has been done and will be continued to be done to, to advise the UK government, or is there any interaction between the Scottish government and the UK government on this, just to make this point clear? Because if it's something that perhaps happens just because of a lack of knowledge, that wouldn't be good. Does that make sense? Does the question make sense? Yeah.
I think it's fair to say that the Scottish Government and the UK Government, I mean, the consultation between the two of them is a matter for them. We have certainly raised the points around some of the technical implications and the challenges in the broader culture around human rights protection and some of the duties on public bodies that have been mooted around the new forthcoming Bill of Rights in respect of some of the specific treaties and some of the rights in the ESCR, the ICESCR treaty that will be brought forward to protect social, economic and cultural rights in the Scottish Government's proposals. It's still, I think, there's still a lot of room for movement around what that Scottish bill looks like. I think we're not at a stage to be able to comment on how those duties might look, but it's a point that we have made and a number of other public bodies have made around fully understanding what some of the difference is for public bodies and understanding their obligations under the Scotland Act and under the Human Rights Act might be.
Thanks for that. Convener, I've got a question around the National Action Plan as well. Are you okay to move on? I should firstly say as well, thanks very much for those answers, but sorry if my first question there was a bit rushed. I wasn't actually expecting the convener to call me that sudden, so lesson to me as a committee member, always be prepared. but there you go. I thought there was somebody else before me. But thanks to the convener. So my second line of questions around the second Scottish National Action Plan. And I know it's been touched on already, but I'm wondering if you think that it will help the Commission in meeting its strategic priorities to promote and protect human rights, and what contribution do you think it will have to the changing human rights landscape in Scotland?
So the Scottish National Action Plan is currently being developed. We are part of the leadership panel with the Scottish Government and a number of other civil society organisations. This has been several years in the making. Some of it was paused during COVID as well. And what the group has been trying to do is agree a set of actions that will be launched as part of a new National Action Plan in the new year. We're getting to the sort of business end of that process just before Christmas. So those actions are being now agreed, the wording. And I think the intention by the Scottish Government is to launch the action plan in March next year. I think, as with everything, and this is maybe something also for the committee to think about and be involved in the year ahead. It's one thing to make commitments, but they need to be followed up. So ensuring that the action plan and all the, there are about 50 actions that I think will be included in that plan, how they'll be resourced, how they'll be prioritised, how they'll be implemented in the years ahead. It's a big piece of work. I think it's could be great for Scotland. It could be transformational. It's being co-produced with civil society and those groups perhaps most affected by inequalities. The plan will only stand up if it's fully delivered and implemented. And I think part of our role as the NHRI is to ensure and monitor the follow-up.
Yeah, and thanks very much for that. I think that's a really important point to make. And I guess it was taking on to the supplementary part of my question about that. And have you got any idea how you'll be able to measure those, if there has been success or outcome or outcomes or if things are moving on? Is that, you know, have you thought about the measurement tools?
That's also currently being discussed within the leadership panel as well. In some areas, it's easier than others. It's always quite challenging in public policy about how you measure impact and success. But there are indicators and proxy indicators that you can use for some of the actions. So, example, rates of child poverty. We've discussed the justice sector already around, you know, prison populations, remand. So there are metrics that can be used. For others, we'll need more sort of qualitative evidence, so feedback from civil society, those with lived experience about what they think and what they feel.
Thank you. Pam Gossel, please.
I just wanted to ask on, you had mentioned earlier on in your opening statement in relation to the sort of work that you're the big areas that you'll be focusing on. Can I ask, how do you come to that conclusion that which areas you would like to focus on and obviously creating your vision and plan?
So some of this is through sort of horizon scanning and working out what are the big issues coming up in terms of the legislative agenda. And the Human Rights Bill is going to be an incorporation, a big piece of work. And I think there is a role for us as the NHRI to lean in on that and make sure it's done well. Also, in terms of responding to lived experience and the feedback that we receive from civil society, we have a lived experience group that represents various communities and individuals. So getting feedback from them helps inform our work and our priorities so that we're really responding to the human rights issues that are pertinent in Scotland. And we've done some recent work on that. I don't know whether, Ailey, you just want to mention about the recent work on ISESCA and some of the lived experience work that we've done.
Yeah, absolutely. So in relation to the current strategic plan, obviously that's what we are working through, and next year will be a strategic plan. The strategic planning year, when the 2020 strategic plan was drafted, we underwent a significant amount of consultation with public bodies that we work with civil society. We had an open call for evidence around what those priorities should be. And it was very clear from doing that work that economic, social and cultural rights were something that was a priority for the public at large and for us. Obviously now we have the incorporation agenda and the potential incorporation of the Convention on ESCR rights. So the strategic priority around economic, social and cultural rights and the protection and understanding of those rights is a big factor in kind of leading our work over the next few years. As an NHRI, we also have a number of responsibilities under international law to report on various treaties, and we are coming into the reporting process for the ISESCA treaty protecting economic, social and cultural rights. So that process will begin in the new year. And the sort of first stage of that is that stakeholders, including NHRIs, produce written reports summarising some of the key concerns. And obviously at the moment we are well aware of some of the impacts around the cost of living crisis. We held a workshop with civil society organisations, asking them around some of the impacts that the cost of living crisis was kind of having on the groups that they work with, and looking at the various treaty articles that ICESCA protects around housing, health, education, culture, looking at the cost of living particularly, and adding that to the workshops that we have done over the last year to inform our universal periodic review work. So all of that it has fed into our report, which we plan to publish early in the new year, and that will be the beginning of what will likely be a process that takes a couple of years in terms of the UK reporting on how it protects economic, social and cultural rights.
Thank you. Sorry.
I think I'm a practical person, so I apologise for being maybe a bit basic, but the rights holders, if rights holders understand their rights and how to access those rights, and that's the most powerful sort of metric that you can have in my book. So it's around about engaging with those individuals and understanding how that happens. And on the website, there's an excellent little film, and it's around about rights in a care home. And this lady says, I always thought rights were something that was out there, but it actually applies to me, and that was a very powerful statement. And I think that's, we need to make sure that the legal and the policies is vital and important, but underneath it is, what's the impact for those that are the rights holders? And are they seeing benefits? Are they seeing change? Are they seeing some more empowerment? And I think that's, for me, is a means by which we identify progress in its broadest sense.
No, thank you. Can I just come back? Ian, obviously, I know I got that call. I'm sure my other colleagues here got that call as well from you, just a catch-up. And one of the questions you had asked was that what is it that's really, the kind of top priorities in our constituencies and in our regions? And I feel that's quite important. I mean, I don't know how many MSPs you've reached out to, maybe just the committee, but all MSPs represent a constituency in regions. So I think it might be good if you reach out to them to see what the top concerns are as well, because we listen, we're on the ground, there, and we listen to people. And I know the cost of living, obviously, you have mentioned that, but there are many other areas as well around in the constituency. So that might be a good idea.
Yeah, thank you. And we're also happy to receive feedback from this committee as well in terms of the casework inquiries that you get. I understand that they're significant, and in some ways that also tells us a picture about the concerns that are being raised at a local level in your communities.
Sorry, I was just going to add that I think it would be an excellent time to raise the predecessor committee's report from 2018 around getting rights right, which talks about an expansive role for the Parliament and a collaborative role between the NHRI and the Parliament in terms of being the protectors of human rights, and how we can ensure that we're working together to ensure accountability for human rights, that the right issues are being raised, that we're giving proper scrutiny to Scottish Government actions and other public bodies' actions. There's a lot of recommendations in that report, and obviously it was published in 2018, so it's kind of, I think, fallen a little bit victim to COVID. But I think it would be a really excellent opportunity for the committee to look at some of those recommendations, taking into account what we've said about our resource and our desire to work collaboratively, and seeing if there might be opportunities to make sure that we regularise that communication between ourselves, not just the committee, but MSP colleagues across the chamber.
Okay, thank you. And Karen Adams, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose this is kind of following on from what we've just been discussing here, what Jim was saying about people understanding their rights, and Ellie, you're talking about, as a whole, as an institution, people knowing what human rights are and how they interact. And Ian, you were saying in your opening statement, training is one of your remits. And I was just wondering, what does that training look like? Who does that apply to? And just for the benefit of the committee, how do you roll that training out?
Yeah, so I think, that's a... there are two sides to our mandate, just sort of stepping back a second, in terms of sort of protecting human rights, our sort of legal and policy analysis, but also promoting human rights. And that's, as Jim was saying, about kind of connecting the legal floor with also making it real for the ordinary person in Scotland. And so part of our job is to communicate and promote that. And we do some of that through training. So we've offered training to parliamentarians. We're happy to do that. We've done sessions on human rights budgeting, on incorporation, on the new human rights bill. But that training is not just for Parliament, but also for other public bodies in Scotland. I think if the human rights bill develops in the way that we think it will, that does bring new obligations to public authorities, public bodies and local authorities in Scotland. And I think part of our role is making sure that those public bodies understand those new obligations. I'm slightly concerned that perhaps not all of them fully understand the implications of a new bill and what it would mean for them, because these rights would be justiciable in Scottish law, meaning that if they're not upheld, citizens can assert their legal rights for remedies. Mm-hmm. And so there's a role for us, I think, in terms of training and working with public bodies to do that. I also might be bold and suggest that that's a critical component for MSPs, as ultimately you are the human rights guarantors in Parliament. And so we suggest that that could form part of the core training for new MSPs coming into Parliament, and we're happy to do that.
Mm. Now that's really interesting. Thank you. Because I think understanding how human rights interacts with all policy and legislation is crucial. I remember being a councillor and we'd read through reports, and we'd get to the end of the report and read how the, you know, the equality impact assessment, you know, worked with this at the end of it. And it just almost seems that it should be flipped on its head, and that should be a foundation, that human rights should be a foundation approach to a lot of things, particularly, you know, working cross committees. How crucial is it that all committees, not just here in the Human Rights Committee, but all committees are taking human rights with, you know, really at the foundation of their policy making and scrutiny?
Yeah, I think that's a good question, and something that we've been trying to work on in the last couple of months. So actually broadening awareness beyond this committee in Parliament. So colleagues recently gave evidence to the Health and Social Care Committee, I think that's the right name, on the National Care Service Bill, some of our concerns about the bill. We've also had colleagues speaking to the Finance Committee on human rights budgeting. So we're happy to do that. I think it's important that this committee is still the functional home for human rights in the Parliament, but we're happy to work with other committees because there's so many cross-cutting issues, particularly around finance, resources, implementation.
Yeah, that's really, if I may, convener, because one thing that struck me when we were discussing COVID, the impacts of COVID, something you noted was the accessibility and locality of resources for people. And people might not necessarily think that the Rural Affairs Committee, for example, would have, you know, any obligation to underpin any kind of human rights. But rural and rurality is quite a hot topic in terms of, you know, our neighbourhoods and how we can access even, you know, healthcare, for example. So it's really interesting to hear your testimonies on that, so to speak. Thank you.
Perhaps I could give a quick response on that, just to say that I mean that's a classic example, I think, of where there's some cross-cutting issues. So we've been working with a women's group in the North Highlands about the difficulties they have accessing gynecological care in remote areas, and there's a sort of trade-off or balance to be struck between offering centralised, very specialised centres of excellence, but also making sure that they're accessible. You know, there are questions about that in some rural parts of Scotland, to what extent sort of centralisation of public services, for understandable reasons, actually puts up a barrier for women accessing healthcare in rural areas.
Julie, fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. On the point you made just a moment ago about the two kind of aspects of your work around protecting the floor and promoting. On protecting the floor, we heard quite a bit in this committee. I sit on two committees and I'm pretty sure it was this one, from a group of learning disabled people who spoke to us about their experience. And it was really clear to me, actually, that the floor that we would expect for them just was not being met. Like the numbers of people who were dying of preventable illnesses, people who were stuck in hospital in the thousands, in some cases for years at a time. How do you think we as a committee can try to ensure through things like the Universal Periodic Review and the review of the 2018 report that you mentioned, Ailey, how can we make sure that floor is protected? And what would you expect to see in terms of not just policy but budget to for us to be able to tell whether or not we are protecting that minimum core, I guess?
Yeah, I'll ask Eddie to speak in detail, but just to say these are some of the issues that we did raise in the Universal Periodic Review specific to Scotland, because they are devolved areas where the Scottish Government does have responsibility. So I think the UPR is a good tool to hold government to account in terms of the recommendations that it's agreed to accept on that area, and also in terms of the resourcing. But Ailey, I know you've been working closely on the UPR.
Yeah, thanks, Ian, and thank you, Pam. Taking different parts of your question, in terms of making sure that the voices of incredibly kind of vulnerable communities are taken into account, we do have a statutory obligation to pay particular attention to marginalised groups, and that is something that we take very seriously, and we also try to mainstream across our work, and one of the ways in which we are thinking about better systematising that in throughout our work and the policy work that we publish is sort of reverting almost back to treaty and looking at the specific treaties that do exist. And there are gaps, obviously, in terms of older persons and LGBTI rights, but the core treaties that the UK has signed up to do include a sort of substantive equality provision around some of the marginalised groups that you refer to. And I think that the committee has an important role in ensuring accountability in a way that we try to do as the NHRI, but this committee has the kind of public, parliamentary, democratic voice in making sure that those reports from the UN, that the scrutiny is kind of brought home. We think of ourselves as the NHRI as the bridge between domestic policy and the international policy. We can advise, we can explain some of the human rights standards that exist, but this committee can really hold government to account and other public bodies to account for the protection and sometimes the regression that we see around some of those standards. So I really would encourage the committee to similarly look at what it can do in the space around the human rights treaties. But they aren't the answer to everything. They are cyclical. There are quite considerable gaps between some of the reporting processes. And so I think it's an important role that we can all play in terms of mainstreaming across different committees, working collectively around human rights budgeting and taking that preventative approach. The Universal Periodic Review, the Commission attended a pre-session for NHRIs and civil society that gave us direct access to some of the representatives from UN member states so that we could spend some time explaining some of our core concerns. We were lucky to have SCLD come from Scotland, so they were able to raise their concerns directly, but obviously not every organisation can do that every time, and we think it's important that we reflect those concerns through the participatory work that we do in developing our reports. So we do try to raise issues of concern on behalf of organisations when they don't have access to those systems, but domestically obviously it's much easier for some of those organisations to participate, and therefore it's great to create a space for them to do that. And just a final comment on the Universal Periodic Review, which is that there was a marked increase in the number of recommendations that came from other member states, the UPR is a peer review system. So under the Human Rights Council, so the most sort of senior standalone human rights body within the UN system, and all states participate as equals. We saw a number of recommendations around tackling structural racism and racial bias. We saw a huge number of recommendations around women's rights, around gender equality, around violence against women. We saw a huge number of recommendations around disability and the exclusion of disabled people from public life, and we saw a number of recommendations around LGBT rights and some of the policy changes that are on the table around LGBT rights. So it was a marked increase in that more sort of focused approach, something that I think we really welcome, and something that I think gives us a really good basis for ongoing dialogue around progressing human rights in Scotland.
Thank you. Can I ask a follow-up? Thank you for that. Do you have a sense as to why there's that increase?
I mean, I think there are a number of reasons. We obviously did advocacy around our report, and some of those issues came up in our report. But it's with all policy, there wasn't a sort of clear sense of why those things had happened. But I would say that I think COVID has certainly shone a light on some of the inequalities that are kind of deeply rooted in different structures around the world. I think that has probably helped the conversation at the international level. But I don't think there's a one simple reason for that increase. We also saw a marked increase in recommendations relating to economic, social and cultural rights and environmental rights. So it's just interesting to watch over time how states, perhaps the focus on one particular human rights doesn't dissipate, but it moves into other terrains.
What's your view on the Scottish Government's response to the recommendations?
The Scottish Government has not responded yet, so we have the draft recommendations, and it will now be up to the UK Government to respond to each of the 302 recommendations. The Scottish Government, we hope, will produce a position statement outlining its own response to some of the recommendations, and we are committed to kind of helping them to understand how some of the higher level recommendations can have a Scottish focus. So for example, where some of the recommendations talk about domestic abuse policy in the UK, obviously in Scotland we have different law and policy, so we open to doing a bit of work to see how we can map some of the recommendations to developments here. I will say for the Scottish Government, I mean, they produced a position statement in October ahead of the UPR that was very comprehensive, obviously setting out the areas of progress, but really going through a huge number of areas of policy. And I think we also should be making sure that we hold Scottish Government accountable for some of its voluntary commitments, as the UPR does.
Just one very, very final question, sorry. Do you know when we could expect the responses?
The UK Government has until March 2023 to respond. Scottish Government, as it doesn't have a formal role in the UPR, doesn't have a deadline, but I would imagine that they'll be working to a similar deadline in terms of wanting to get a response relatively quickly.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Chair. 2 weeks ago, the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women and Girls, Reem Aslam, raised a number of concerns about the Scottish Government proposed gendered recognition reforms. As you will be aware, Ms. Aslam raised concerns that the proposed reforms could open the door to violent males who identify as men to abuse the process of acquiring a gender certificate and the rights associated with it. This present risks to safety of women in all their diversity. Does the Scottish Human Rights Commission have any comments to make on this intervention by the United Nations? And do you agree with Reem Aslam that the bill should be postponed so that the concerns such as this can be properly addressed?
So yes, we've seen the letter. We're still working through it. She is one voice of several within the UN. There are a range of opinions within the UN. I note that the letter she recently submitted contradicts an earlier letter that she sent in 2021, where she appeared to support self-ID with a number of other UN special rapporteurs. We're still working through our response. My personal view is I'm not convinced that she's presented new evidence that has not already been debated at length within Parliament. We presented our evidence in June. That was after I think the committee had heard from lots of other individuals and groups. So we tried in that evidence session to respond as well to the evidence that you'd heard previously. I am concerned as well about a sort of underlying narrative that's being developed that trans people are sexual predators. I worry about that because they are a marginalised and vulnerable group. I recognise that this bill is contested. It's up to parliamentarians now to reach their conclusions, but our initial view is that we stand by the evidence that we gave in June. And recognise that there is a range of opinions, including within the UN.
Can I come back? Yeah. Thank you, Ian. Just on that, you know, mentioning you're absolutely right, and I've mentioned this many times in this committee and in the chamber, that rights should be for everybody, and that's why, obviously, human rights, you're here today. And talking about these rights, that yes, they should be there to protect trans people as well as women and girls. And that's why the concern is there that you don't want these predators out there to be pretending and obtain a GRC to do it. So you've talked about basically there's concerns. You have mentioned that either way. Do you not think it would be a good idea if the Scottish Government postponed the bill to look at these concerns because they have been highlighted? We can't just dismiss somebody from the United Nations saying something now. And I know that you're saying that, you know, they said something else before, but it's very clear this is said now. So shouldn't we be looking at that? But also, this is to protect the trans people as well, so that they don't get blamed later on for something. Because I think, I mean, I've said it very, very plain and clear in this committee that we should have rights for everybody. And we need to make sure that trans people really need those rights, and they have been fighting for them so that they get their rights. But also we make sure that women and girls are safe from the actual real bad people, not the trans people here. Yeah.
So I think some of the concerns that the special rapporteur has mentioned in her recent letter have been looked at length by this committee. So our understanding of the equalities law in the UK means that it would still be possible to exclude trans women from women's safe sex spaces if there's a justifiable reason to do so. And we think that the bill is appropriate in terms of striking that balance and offering, simplifying a process that already exists in terms of issuing gender recognition certificates. I don't know whether my colleague Ailey wants to add anything, given that you've followed this file for many years.
Thanks, Ian. I think we are still working through the letter, and we're obviously aware of a couple of civil society letters that have also been exchanged with the Special Rapporteur, and the Special Rapporteur indicates her desire to respond to those. As members of this committee know, I worked in the women's sector for a very long time, so I have been across this particular issue and have looked through the letter from Rima Sleem. One of the things that we noted was that the advice that she presented did not appear to be Scotland specific. There were a number of references to the Women's Inequalities Committee and to the prison services in England and Wales and how they do their allocations, which is different to Scotland. So we were not convinced that the letter, our preliminary view is that the letter doesn't raise anything new. We're still kind of keeping an open mind as to what the civil society responses might say. But again, we would encourage the committee to listen to the voices of the women's sector who use the trans exceptions in the Equality Act and understand how those work in practice. And really, you know, the Equality Act is what would be the basis for doing an exclusion. So the Gender Recognition Act, in our view, wouldn't change that.
Thank you. I'm probably worth just for the record, just as far as I'm aware,
I don't think Ms. Aslim made any attempt to contact the committee to present any evidence through the entirety of our stage one or stage two. Ian?
Just to say that we had no contact with the special rapporteur either, so we were not aware of the letter until it was published. Yeah.
So maybe there's a clarity thing there in terms of where the research that she did to justify the letter came from. Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, Mr. Doddy, I think, just if I'm right in what you're saying, I'm not sure if you referenced Ms. Al-Salam's letter correctly, because she said, however, I share the concern that such proposals would potentially open the door for violent males who identify as men to abuse the process of acquiring a gender certificate and the rights associated with it. This presents potential risks to the safety of women in all their diversity, including women born female, trans women and gender non-conforming women. So I just wanted to put that on the record. In your submission or your reply, your response to the UN Special Rapporteur, when will the committee see that? When is it likely to be completed? And with regards to the... We know that, obviously, we can use exceptions. Women's services can use exceptions in services for trans people through the Equality Act. But why do you think, and will you address this in your response, why do you think that Reem talks about her concern around the access to single sex spaces for women and invites the Scottish Government to broaden its discussions, examinations and reform process beyond the changes wishes to introduce to the GRA? I mean, I think it's important that we recognise that women do feel safe as well as trans people. So I wonder if that will be as part of your letter in that response.
So, and very much so. We think that women's rights and trans rights can go hand in hand. Human rights are indivisible. We don't think of a hierarchy of rights. My reference to underlying narrative was not a reference to that letter per se, but to the debate in general around comments being made, particularly on social media, around predatory trans people, which I worry about. We recognise the comments that the Special Rapporteur has made. We do think that they have been addressed several times within this committee. This debate has been going on now for a number of years. I can't speculate for the reasons why she wrote in at this time or who she contacted to get her evidence.
And Maggie?
Yeah, thanks very much for your comments on this. I just, Ian, in your initial response to Pam Gosol's question, you said that you stand by the evidence you gave in June. At that meeting, I think it was the same meeting, we also heard from the United Nations independent expert on the protection from violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity, Victor Madrigal-Bolot. And in that, he was quite clear that in work that he has undertaken, that this so-called alleged competition of rights has come up before, and he has found no evidence to support that there's any systematic or identifiable pattern or risk in the situation created by self-ID legal recognition. I wonder whether whether the SHRC would agree with that view of the position on the situation, and whether in your understanding of where legal recognition by self-identification works in other countries, whether there's been any evidence to suggest that it can be that conflict that the letter referred to by Pam and Rachel earlier indicates. Thanks.
Thanks. Yes, we were at the committee session in June where the committee also took evidence from the independent expert on sexual orientation and gender identity. So there's a diversity of views within the UN. I think I should stress as well, though, that the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights has also come out in support of self-ID. There are a number of states who already have self-ID. We haven't seen the concrete harms that have been hinted at throughout this debate. Therefore, you know, we still stand by our position that we gave in June, because looking also at the evidence from countries that have introduced self-ID, I think some of those concerns that were expressed have not materialised. Mm-hmm. I think I should also emphasise that in our evidence in June, we did say that we did recommend that the legislation be reviewed in 2 years' time to see how it works in practice. So I think we would still stand by that recommendation. Perhaps I can just ask my colleague Aileith if there's anything she'd like to add.
Not especially. I think it's important to remind the committee members that countries that have introduced self-ID, and there are now a number of them, have different processes, different equality and different different exemptions that may apply. So some countries do have exceptions like the Equality Act that allows service providers to exclude a person on the basis of their gender reassignment status, regardless of their sex, legal, biological, presentational, whatever. Comparing countries is challenging, but we haven't seen any evidence that this has been a systemic problem. And as I say, the exceptions in the Equality Act exist for a reason, and it's not for this commission. We're not the equality regulator. We can't go into some of the detail about how the Equality Act exceptions work. But the Equality and Human Rights Commission obviously has a role there to advise service providers on how to use those exceptions properly, and maybe that advice needs to be updated in light of self-ID, but it would be entirely a matter for them.
Okay, thanks very much for that clarity. Thanks.
Fulton? No. Okay, I think that then concludes our session. So just to finish by saying a huge thank you to all three of you for what was a really interesting session. We'll now move into private for the remaining items on our agenda.